next question quickly. A lot of people have asked me the same thing. That's why I'm putting you with this question. What are your views for the Bhav Chalit chart? When do you personally use Bhav Chalit chart?
Okay. Since you said, where do you use? I use Chalit more than Bhav Chalit.
Okay.
Because to me, the degree of ascendant is prime.
Okay.
Now the house correlation, the length of the house is not so important to me. Because our Vedic system is more based on the nakshatras.
Right.
So if a planet is of long ascension, it doesn't make a difference whether it is 31 degrees or 29 degrees. To me, what matters is the nakshatra, the continuous progress of the nakshatra. So I see Chalit more than Bhav Chalit, because Chalit is based on the degree of the ascendant. So I know where exactly the planet is placed, whether it is placed in this house or that
house. That house.
For me, Bhav Chalit is less important. People see it, I respect it, I read it. But the way I see it, to me, Vedic based interpretation with the combination of nakshatra, the sign, the elements, to me, Chalit is more important than Bhav Chalit. So I don't see Bhav Chalit.
Okay.
But I see that what planet is moved from the next sign or the next house. To me, that's important because it is nakshatra based. That's
right. Right, right. But have you seen in your analysis, have you seen, is the Bhav Chalit working more prominent in your research, or is the Chalit chart is working more?
I mean, it doesn't work like this.
Okay.
It's the system that you follow.
Okay.
If you're following the house based system. Okay.
It depends upon
you, you will talk about Chalit, but you're talking about other aspects. Let's say the ascension of the sign, the other importance. You are talking about house correlation. Then you say about Bhav Chalit.
Okay.
It's what you follow.
Okay.
It's what you follow. I follow a certain paddhati where I look at Chalit.
Okay. Okay.
That is my paddhati. That is why I said, when you asked me, what do you see? So this is my way of interpretation.
Okay.
For me, the elements are prime.
Right.
To me, the sign is of the most importance.
Important.
Because having a Taurus, let's say Rahu, in seventh house, or let's say having a Taurus Rahu in the sixth house, or Taurus Rahu in the 11th house, is way too different things. Right. Having a Taurus Rahu in the seventh house would not be that good. But having it in the 6th house or the 11th house is excellent.
Yeah.
So to me, signs are of utmost importance.
Okay.
They change the nature of the planet. The house cannot change the nature of the planet.
Right.
Saturn in the 10th house is going to behave in the 10th house any way it wants.
Right.
It is there for the upliftment. You will slowly but steadily progress towards greater heights.
Right.
But what if that Saturn is in number 2, Taurus? What if it is number 10? In the 10th house itself, what is it if it is in Pisces? The importance of 10th house remains, the importance of Saturn remains, but the moment you change the sign, complete analysis of the horoscope changes, complete.
Right, right.
So to me, Chalit is more important.
Okay, we are coming back to the next Q&A. Again, this is a very common question. Beautiful. Okay, we are coming to the last question because I know you also have to go. Again, this was asked by many people. Lot of people have asked me that in their chart, lot of people have no planets in Kendras, but lot of cluster of planets in 6, 8 and 12. So will their life will be doomed? Will they have to go through a hell lot of a time all the time? How you see and what suggestion do you have when people are having a lot of planets or only planets in 6, 8, 12?
So what? Your problem kya hai? Are you worried about the cluster or you're worried about the house?
People
are worried about the house. Then one of the greatest person to see about all the combinations in the 8th house is Mr. Amitabh Bachchan.
Right. Yeah. Lot of planets.
No superstar. He's the biggest superstar in the world.
Yeah.
Recognized all over the world.
Yeah.
You know, major planets in the 8th house. What's the problem? The problem is people feel that 8th house is bad.
Right.
It's not like that. Cluster is bad. Cluster anyway is any even in the 9th house is bad, even in the 3rd house is bad.
Right. Yes.
I'll give you a small example.
Yes.
If you have no planet in 3rd house, you will become somebody in life, big or small. But you have cluster in your 3rd house, you will only be living for day-to-day life. Working for somebody, making two ends meet. The 3rd house is the house of courage. It is good to have more planets there. But why is it the other way around? Why is it the other way around? If I have more planets in the 3rd house, I'm really working hard, but I'm not becoming rich.
Right.
Because your focus of the planets is on hard work, not on becoming rich.
Rich.
But if my 3rd house is empty, but the 3rd lord is placed in the 11th house, I am not hell bent upon working hard. I am hell bent upon working hard to become rich. Not working even. And I want to become rich.
Perception is changed.
It's changed totally. So why do you get worried when you have so many planets in the 8th house? Why do you get worried?
Right.
What happens is the cluster is bad because paraspar do se zyada grah ek hi ghar mein ho to wo aapas mein shatru ho jate. Meaning, if more than two planets, even the best of the friends, are placed in one house, they become temporal enemies. Then our struggle, yes, our life struggle increases. How to balance both the planets?
Okay.
The struggle increases. So if somebody has major planets in the 8th house, no problem. Learn to balance them. Don't be lethargic. Don't postpone things. Be very, very punctual. Get up early in the morning and see what kind of planets aspect from the 8th house or through the 2nd house. If they are sattvic, be a vegetarian. Because 2nd is the house of eating. It's the mouth.
Yes. Yes.
If Jupiter is placed in the 8th house, it's not good for marriage. If Surya is placed with Jupiter, it can give a yoga, but still not good for health. Tamasic planet aspecting the 2nd house, the more non-vegetarian or other things you have, more problems you will have.
Right.
Simply you have to see. 6th house is an Upachya house. Having malefics in 6th house is always better than having benefics in the 6th house. So if you have a Mars, you have a Ketu, you have a Rahu, you have a Saturn, all good in the 6th house. But you have a Jupiter, you have Venus, you have Moon, not good in the 6th house. Upachya. 3, 6, 10, 11. Malefics do well here. Benefics do not do well here.
Right.
Out of the 6th, 8th and 12th, the 8th is the most dangerous house.
Okay.
Because it's the house of delays. You keep on working for it, you may not get it in this lifetime. Bad thing. 6th house is the house of Upachya. It can take you many folds high. 12th is the most poised house of comfort of the body.
Yeah.
That is why they say having Jupiter, having Ketu in the 12th house is the karak for moksha. Because you have no happiness from the body. You are always, always working on doing things, doing things, doing things, doing things, because you have so much to accomplish. So the Shastra says, no, that you have a 12th house Ketu, oh, you will get more.
Yeah, that's
because you are here to finish all your pending karmas. But if you have Venus, what do they say? What do they say? They say you'll have the most luxurious life.
Yes.
I know really beautiful people who have not worked their life, but have got all the richness because they have some very, very connected friends. Most of them have Venus in the 12th house. Empty pockets, they go all around the world. Empty pockets, they go all around the world. They don't have a place to pay the rent for the house, but they are living in the best of the houses.
Yeah.
This is destiny.
Right. See, Bia, this is the thing which I admire the most, which we all learn from you, from RUKETU. I know time is always the essence here, but it was a short session. We can always do more session because there still I have a list of queries related to Ketu, which is keep pending from the last couple of months, because a lot of people ask me that we want to learn. We want to learn Ketu ruled Nakshatra from RUKETU.
Again, that Nakshatra thing, no?
Right.
I would request everybody who's learning astrology, because you'll be learning astrology at least from 7 births, at least one birth is not going to, you know, make us learn astrology.
Right.
I have been doing it from my childhood. I don't think till my grave I'll be reading and understanding. But Nakshatra based is something different. Don't jump straight to Nakshatra.
Nakshatras, yeah.
The environment, if you want to understand Ketu, I just explain it to you in simple terms. Ketu in water is good.
Okay, in the water sign, 4-8-12.
In the 4-8 sign, it is good. It's very good. Because the intuitive level increases.
Increases, yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Now I ask you something. What are the nakshatra rising in the last part or 4-8-12?
All the Gandanta nakshatras.
Jupiter, Saturn, Mercury.
Yeah. Yeah.
Understand?
Yeah.
That means that Ketu has some connection, beautiful connection with Jupiter. That is the Lord of Wisdom. Okay, I understand if I am wise and I have a beautiful Ketu, my intuition level or other things are going to increase. The second thing is, it's got Mercury.
Mercury, yes.
Jupiter, Saturn and Mercury. Saturn is the most beautiful Karak of becoming an aesthetic, of becoming one of the greatest masters on this earth. With a Saturn Ketu combination in the horoscope.
Yes.
These people have been a yogi. They will become a yogi. Finally, by the end of their life, they will become a yogi.
Yes.
Let's say you have Ketu in the Mercury Nakshatra.
Yes.
Your intellect on the initial years is going to trouble you a lot. As in when you grow in life, your intellect is going to teach you. This world is a mithya. It's a false illusion.
Maya.
No matter how much you want to get into it, it'll take you out of it. So the three great gods of wisdom, moksha, are there what you call about your gantanta.
Right.
That is why I say, in my opinion, things are very, very different than people what they see. It's right. Very, very different.
No, that is why we wanted to learn from you, that what is your perspective?
My perspective is this. If you want to learn about Ketu, you want to understand the sign that it behaves in. Then understand the nakshatra it goes about.
Right.
Sometimes a Saturn-Ketu combination, even in the nakshatra, is an excellent combination for moksha. Excellent combination.
Right. Right. But Bhav, very quickly I wanted to ask you, this is the personal question from me. I always wanted to know why all the nakshatras, Gandanta nakshatras, are between Ketu and Mercury. This is, nobody has asked that, why not Sun, Saturn, Sun, Venus? Why everything is happening between Ketu and Mercury? So it has very big significance, I'm pretty sure.
Ketu or nakshatra ke beech mein to every nakshatra is going to come between Ketu and Mercury. Ketu, Venus, Sun, Moon, Mars, Jupiter, Saturn, Mercury, you know, the association is between this only. So every nakshatra is between Ketu and Mercury.
Right.
I'm not able to understand the question. It starts with Ketu. Aries, first degree starts with Ketu. Pisces, last degree ends with Revati.
Revati.
The combination is between Ketu and Mercury. From what God has given me as an intellect, as the Holy Spirit inside me, I move it to Mercury, to the intellect of my own earthy level, where I think that I am the most intelligent human being on this earth.
Right.
This is the journey that I am born with certain plus points. But I converted myself with my own logic and understanding. The human mind is so stupid. Without the grace of God, without the intellect, without the intuition, it will never progress in life. What we do is we block those things.
Thanks. Yeah.
And we try to work on our own intellect. This is where things go wrong. I think this is the journey from Mercury to Ketu. It's one step only. okay, from my intellect to his intellect. It's just one step. From Mercury, it's Ketu. But from Ketu to Mercury, it takes 6 steps to come to Mercury.
Wow.
So if I leave my own intellect, trust my main man,
he's going to take you to Ketu.
But if I want to do all the things myself, that I am doing it, I am the one who is doing it, I ultimately get to Mercury, which gets me into a lot of troubles, mental, emotional, stress, depression, all the problems.
The natural sixth house. The natural sixth house. Beautiful, beautiful. Thank you. Thank you, RUKETU. Thank you, Bhav. We would love to have you back again, because again, just like I mentioned, the list is still very big. But I know you have to go, and I will let you go. Please come back again very soon and enlighten us with more Q&A. Thank you.
Thank you for having me, Pranam. Thank you for listening.
Thank you.